Hello everybody, I am Dr. Meenakshi Rana. I am working as an academic consultant in the Department of Physics, Uttarakhand Open University, Haldwani. Today, my video lecture presentation is Semiconductor Diodes. Here is the content of my video lecture. I will discuss the learning outcome of this video lecture, classification of materials based on the energy band gap, different types of semiconductors, intrinsic semiconductors and extrinsic semiconductors. In extrinsic semiconductors, I will discuss the p-type semiconductors and n-type semiconductors. I will also discuss the p-n junction and its characteristics, p-n junction diode and its IV characteristics. First, I will discuss the learning outcome of this video lecture presentation. After studying this video lecture, you should be able to define the semiconductors, can understand different types of semiconductors, know various energy bands and charge carriers in semiconductors, and can understand working characteristic and junction of p-n junction diode and its IV characteristics. We can classify the materials based on the energy gaps in basically three types, as metals, insulators and in semiconductors. In case of metals, they have free electrons and have partially filled valence band. So in this case, the valence band and conduction band overlap. So they have very high conductivity, as shown in this figure. In case of insulators, they have filled valence band and empty conduction band, which are separated by a very large band gap of the order of greater than 3 electron volt. That is why they have very high value of resistivity. In case of semiconductors, they have similar band structure as insulators but with a very small band gap of the order of less than 3 electron volt. In this case, due to this less band gap, some electron jump from the empty conduction band by thermal or optical excitation. The examples of semiconductors are silicon, germanium, gallium arsenide and many more. They can be of elemental type or can be compound form. Now, the different types of semiconductor. We can classify semiconductor in broadly two types, as intrinsic semiconductors and extrinsic semiconductors. In case of intrinsic semiconductor, the semiconductors are free of doping of any type of impurity. And in extrinsic semiconductor, these type of semiconductors are formed when we added some impurities in pure type of semiconductor. Basically, doping is a process of adding a certain amount of an specific impurity, normally called dopant, to a pure type of semiconductor to enhance or increase the electrical conductivity of a pure type of semiconductor. Now, we will discuss the intrinsic type of semiconductor in detail. Basically, the semiconductors which are in a pure form are known as intrinsic semiconductors, such as the pure germanium, silicon, gallium and arsenic are the example of intrinsic type semiconductors. At room temperature, in case of intrinsic semiconductors, the number of electrons and the number of holes are equal. Basically, these holes and the electrons are the two types of the charge carriers which are responsible for the flow of current in a semiconductor materials. The energy band gap for intrinsic semiconductors are shown here. In case of intrinsic type semiconductor, the Fermi level is in between the valence band and the conduction band. These are the examples of the intrinsic type semiconductors. As silicon, it has a valency of 4 and the germanium have also 4 valence electrons. Similarly, the gallium and the arsenic have 3 and 5 valence electrons respectively. These are the pure type of semiconductors and the examples of intrinsic semiconductors. Now, we will discuss the extrinsic semiconductors. As we already discussed, the extrinsic type semiconductors are the materials in which the doping of impurities in a pure type semiconductors occurs. The extrinsic semiconductors can be further classified in two types as n-type semiconductors and p-type semiconductors. The n-type semiconductors are formed when we added a pentavalent impurities to a pure semiconductors, we get n-type semiconductors. As in this case, we added an antimony to a pure type of semiconductor materials and we observe a n-type semiconductor material. Basically, antimony atom has a 5 valence electron and this 5th valence electron is an extra electron and it becomes free electron and enters into the conduction band. Therefore, this pentavalent impurity donates 1 electron and becomes a positive donor. So, this pentavalent impurity is also known as a donor impurity. Now, the p-type semiconductors. In p-type semiconductors occur when we add a trivalent impurities to a pure semiconductor, we observe a p-type of semiconductor material. As we added a boron impurity in a pure type of material and get a p-type of semiconductor. Basically, a boron atom have a 3 valence electron and it easily makes the covalent bond with the adjacent 3 valence band, 3 valence electrons of the silicon atom. There is a deficiency of one covalent bond and it creates a hole. Therefore, the trivalent impurity accepts one electron and becomes a negative acceptor ion. So, this trivalent impurity is also known as acceptor impurity. We can compare this n-type semiconductors and p-type semiconductors as follows. Basically, in n-type semiconductors, the pentavalent impurities are added, while in p-type, the trivalent impurities are added. In case of n-type material, the majority charge carriers are electrons, while the minority charge carriers are holes. While in case of p-type material, the majority charge carriers are holes, while the minority charge carriers are electrons. In case of n-type materials, the Fermi level is near to the conduction band. While in case of p-type material, the Fermi level is near to the valence band. Now, what is the p-n junction? We will discuss what is p-n junction. A p-n junction is formed when an n-type of material on a p-type of semiconductor material are joined together and the boundary between this p-type and n-type region is called a junction. At the p-n junction, the electrons from n side move towards the p side and recombine with these holes and the holes from the p side move towards to the n side where they recombine with the electrons. As a result of this flow of electron from n side and hole from the p side creates a positive, a net positive charge to the n side and a negative charge towards the p side. Now, there is a concept of a depletion layer. The region around the junction is left where there is no holes and no free electrons is known as depletion layer. This depletion layer is basically a neutron region where there is no charge carriers exist. Because as there is no charge exist, there is no conductivity of electricity. Means this depletion layer where there is no charge carrier is a poor conductor of electricity. Now, the biasing in the p-n junction. Basically, the p-n junction biasing is categorized in two parts as forward biasing and reverse biasing. In case of forward biasing, the positive side of the diode is connected to the positive side of the supply and negative side of the diode is connected to the negative side of the supply. Similarly, in reverse bias, positive side of the diode is connected to the negative side of the supply, whereas the negative side of the diode is connected to the positive side of the supply. Now, we will discuss the diode. Basically, diode is an electronic device that creates by bringing the n-type and the p-type regions within the same semiconductor lattice, and it is mainly used for the rectifiers and LED. There are some characteristics of diode as these diodes are always conducting one direction and it always conducts a current when it is in forward biasing. Forward biasing means positive side of the diode is connected to the positive terminal of the supply and negative side of the diode is connected to the negative side of the supply. Means for this case there is no resistance and there is a flow of current or conductivity of a current. In case where there is a reverse biasing, the diode do not conduct due to the infinite resistance. Now, the IV characteristics of an ideal diode. When an ideal diode is forward biased, it acts as a perfect conductor with zero voltage across it, as shown this. Similarly, when the diode is reverse biased, it acts as a perfect insulator with no current or zero current. So, this shows the IV characteristics of an ideal diode. Now, the IV characteristics of a practical diode. Then, this is the symbol of a practical diode and this symbol denotes the diode. When the diode is forward biased, a forward current passes through the diode and it operates in this top right quadrant of this IV characteristic. When the forward biased voltage exceeds the diode p-n junction internal barrier voltage, which is of the order of 0.7 volt in case of silicon, an avalanche occurs and forward current increases rapidly for a very small increase in the voltage and it produces a non-linear curve. This is known as the knee voltage. Similarly, when the diode is in reverse biased, means cathode is in positive with respect to the anode, the diode blocks the current except for an extremely small leakage current as shown in this figure and operates in the lower left quadrant of this IV characteristic. The diode continues to block the current flow through it until the reverse voltage across the diodes become greater than its breakdown voltage and in sudden increase in the reverse current producing a fairly straight line downwards as the voltage loses current. This reverse breakdown voltage point is used to good effect with the Zener diode, which we will discuss in our further video lectures. I hope you have understand the concept of semiconductor materials and p-n junctions and p-n junction diode. In our further lectures, we will study different types of available diodes as vector diodes, Zener diodes and tunnel diode and many more. Thank you so much. Thank you for your kind attention.